Hi, my name is Alex Jibalisco, Manager of Equity and Inclusion at the City of Spokane. Today we're at High Bridge Park with Margo Hill, Spokane Tribal member. So Margo, thank you for joining us at the Spokane Equity Spotlight. It's a segment that where we want to highlight members that are doing a lot of great equity work. And yeah, if you don't mind just sharing a little bit about yourself. I know you wear many hats and run into you into so many different spaces.
Okay, sure. Thanks for having me, Alex. Margo Hill, I'm a Spokane Tribal citizen. I grew up on the Spokane Indian Reservation out in Wahpenet, and then went off to college, and I earned my Juris Doctorate of Law from Gonzaga. I served as attorney for my tribe for a decade. And then I got another master's in urban regional planning from Eastern Washington University, where I serve as associate professor, urban planning.
Yeah, and we see, I think, a lot of your work reflected around equity or planning, and we get to have a lot of conversations with many of your students. And then you also wear many hats. But what motivated you to get into equity work? Is it something that was always there for you?
So as I mentioned, I grew up on the reservation. Yep. And so my whole life, I've been in the tribal communities. My mom, my grandma, my great-grandma, all traveled throughout the different reservations. On any given week, I can be on three or four different reservations. Yesterday, I was doing a training workshop at the Coeur d'Alene tribe in Idaho. Tomorrow I'll be out in Wahpenet. You know, last weekend I was at Kalispell Tribe. So I'm just all over the place. And equity, for tribal people, for so many decades, we weren't welcome in our own city. The city of Spokane, these are the homelands of the Spokane, the Spokane tribe. Yet for, once more settlers and Europeans moved into the city, tribal people knew that they had to be to the far side of town, or where Drumhill or Springs is now located, at dusk. You know, my grandmothers would say, when it got dark, we needed to be to the far side of town. Our horse and buggy, in fact, because there was dusk to dawn expectations that there weren't people of color in the city. So I remember that. I remember being a child here in the city of Spokane, and people staring at my grandmothers and my family, brown people in the city of Spokane. We just weren't made to feel welcome, even though these were our homelands. So it's always been important to me to support Native people that live here in the city, to provide opportunity, whether it's through education or just feeling welcome.
Like I said, we see a lot of your work in many different spaces. Is there a story that attaches to you of like, that makes you feel motivated to continue showing up in various different spaces?
That's a great question. One story that I think of as far as equity in the city of Spokane, my grandmother, Ida Pion Boyd, was an interpreter for chiefs. She was fluent in our tribal dialect, super smart, and probably spoke three or four Salish dialects. And interpreter for Chief Sam Boyd. And she moved to the city of Spokane. She, of course, spoke English as well. She worked as a waitress at the Davenport Hotel. And she married a non-native. And when she was buying the home, the neighbors freaked out when they seen her brown brothers move her in. And they contacted the homeowner and they canceled the sale. And so, Spokane tribal people were not welcome or allowed to buy homes in the city of Spokane. And so I always think of that. We don't have generational wealth because of that very factor, that we weren't welcome here. And so our people struggle. you know, I'm an urban planning professor, and with the skyrocketing cost of housing, just basic living in the city of Spokane is a real struggle for tribal people.
What do you see as opportunities for collaboration with the city of Spokane? What are some spaces that we could do better?
So first I will say that I've really appreciated working primarily with city council. You know, as you mentioned, I bring my students down to City Hall. We go to city council meetings. But also over the past few years, we've had great partnerships and collaborations. You know, we worked to change the name from Fort George Wright Drive, just down the road here, to Huistox Way. And I appreciate city council's leadership and willingness to do that. You know, that name, George Wright Drive, really was honoring a man that committed genocide against my people. You know, they hung our leaders, they burned down our villages and our food storages, and slaughtered our horses. And so it is a real assault on our humanity when there's a road honoring him. Mm-hmm. And so when City Council and Planning Commission worked to change that name and asked the Spokane tribe, hey, what would you like to see? And the tribe, you know, talked to other tribes and chose to honor a warrior woman, Huistox. It was a powerful moment. You know, I also appreciate the City Council. If ever I ask them to speak to my students, they're always willing to do that. But they continue to make space for people of color, for the Spokane tribe, whose homelands mm-hmm. we are privileged to live in. And I appreciate also the very ground that we're sitting on. The City Council supported an effort to return these lands to the American Indian Community Center. I'm currently the chair of the board of directors of the American Indian Community Center, and we have had to move 11 times. And we serve all of the community. You know, we have a food bank, we have a parent and family services program, you know, we have education and work. We owe a, you know, getting people to work, housing program. We do so much amazing work here in the city of Spokane, yet we don't have a permanent home. And so I appreciate that the City Council has supported the effort for the American Indian Community Center to have a permanent home.
So I think Highbridge Park, we're close to the river, Leyte and Spokane River. So there's a lot of exciting things happening in this space. Is there any other projects or programs, changes that you see that motivate you or inspire you for the future generations of Spokane tribe members living in the city?
So I do a lot of work mm-hmm. in environmental planning. You know, right here we have the Spokane River. We are so blessed as a community to have such a beautiful, powerful resource. We need to protect it. You know, I work with Spokane River Keepers environmental organizations across the city, the Lands Council, Conservation Northwest, really to look at water quality. You know, of course, the tribes are the original stewards of natural resources and the Spokane River. Right here in Spokane, we have UCUT, Upper Columbia United Tribes, and we have scientists and people on the ground working to protect the water quality of the Spokane River. We are so fortunate to have this amazing resource. Of course, we're called the River City, mm-hmm. right? And the river is connected to our aquifer, which is our drinking water. So really all of the community benefits when tribes and environmentalists and advocates work to have a clean river. The other issue is that we are reintroducing salmon. And we've been working on that for our scientists at the different tribes have been working on that for a number of years. It encourages restoration of the habitat so salmon can thrive. Right now, due to low water flows, the temperature in some areas of the river is so low that it threatens all life. And our salmon and our other trout, red band trout, are threatened. And so we really, as citizens, need to think about not just water quality, but also water flow temperature. We need the river to be running clean, cold, and fast.
Well, thank you for a lot of the information that you're sharing with us. One of the parts of the interviews that we want to do is I'll just actually get to know you a little bit more as well. And if there's a place in Spokane that you like to hang out on your free time, where would you advise us to go?
Oh, gosh. So I live in North Spokane.
Mm-hmm.
And I have three children. And we used to go down to the Little Spokane River. And there's a number of locations. You know, there's Pine River Park. But there's other locations where, you know, my kids would go swimming. But now that the tribes are reintroducing salmon, they gather at the Little Spokane River. And we sing our songs again. You know, ever since we've had hydropower and dams that cut off the free-flowing nature of the river, it's a real struggle for our salmon.
Mm-hmm.
But I think of the stories of my great-grandmother. You know, next year we have Expo 74, the 50th celebration. And my great-grandmother, Sadie Boyd, used to tell the history of the Spokane tribe and how we lived and fished on these banks of the Spokane River. And we're really looking forward to partnering with the city and celebrating the 50th anniversary of Expo 74. I think Expo 74 did a lot for our city, mm-hmm. in that it caused us to take a look. It was the first expo based on, you know, natural resources and cleaning up mm-hmm. areas. And we used our river as a dumping ground for sewer, for sawdust.
Yeah.
You know, much of mainstream America wants to put everything to work, natural resources. And so we were using the river as a dumping ground. But today the city has worked really hard to clean up the Spokane River. We realize it's a valuable resource that's connected to our aquifer, which is our drinking water.
Yeah.
So we have storage tanks,
mm-hmm.
and we have invested into infrastructure, the cleanup of the river. And so I really appreciate about the city of Spokane, that we recognize how important that in our language, we call it intwet, which is the word for river. And the falls, had place of fast moving water. And that's really, you know, my great grandmother told the creation story, and I won't go into it. But it starts at front, you know, there were two young Spokane Indians, a young boy and girl, up at Mount Spokane.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was a flood, and there was an earthquake, and you know, we had all this water. And now geologists confirmed the Missoula floods and, you know, all the things that created Spokane. But as the water receded, that young boy, that the young Spokane Indian boy and girl followed the water, and they said, "Ani, Huichin, look, what is that crawling in the water?" And it was a salmon, and they followed it to the falls, the Sket. And that's where we had our first villages, and that's where we live. We have such abundant resources here in Spokane, and so we are all fortunate, all of us as residents of this city.
And a lot of deep history.
Yes. We have a book called The Spokane River, mm-hmm. which is edited by Paul Linholt. And there's lots of contributions by tribal people, Barry Moses, myself, Sherman Alexie. And it's an amazing book that tells all about our city. So I encourage your listeners to take a look at the Spokane River. And the archaeology dates us back 10-12,000 years, so it's a really a good read.
Definitely recreate a little Spokane and Spokane River, and now we have a book recommendation. It's Spokane River. What is a place that you enjoy eating at?
Oh gosh, that's an easy one, right? My partner and I do a lot to support Native-owned businesses.
Okay.
And right here in the city of Spokane, we have Indigenous Eats.
Okay.
Andrew and Jenny Slagle, have an amazing restaurant over on Hamilton in the Gonzaga district. It's called Indigenous Eats. And so every first Thursday, we host a young Native professionals event there at Indigenous Eats. But they have Indian tacos, they have powwow burgers with huckleberry relish. And so I highly recommend Indigenous Eats. The best fry bread, Jenny Slagle uses her grandma's recipe, okay. Insists on it. She's a Yakima tribal citizen. And, you know, we buy Native, support Native, yeah. And I think we can do that for people of color. I also have some favorite barbecue restaurants, okay. too, but okay. we'll just go with Indigenous Eats.
Okay, perfect. And that just reminded me, when we celebrated Wistok's Way opening, mm-hmm. how many leaders that we have in Spokane that identify as Indigenous to the area or many of the local tribes?
Yeah, you know, when we changed the name, the Spokane tribe wanted to honor not only the warrior women of the 1800s that went into battle to protect their families and villages, but also the Indigenous women of today. Mm-hmm. So, you know, oftentimes American Indians, we're invisible to mainstream America. Yeah. They don't see us, they don't pay attention to us. But we are here and we are in full force in the city of Spokane. Yeah. We have educators, we have a good number of Indigenous nurses mm-hmm. that serve all of our communities at the hospitals, at the clinics, at the different medical facilities across the city. We have Indigenous lawyers and teachers, educators, a whole range of Indigenous women and men for that matter that are serving this great community. So when the Spokane tribe changed the name to Wistok's Way, they wanted to honor not just the warrior women of the past, but also the Indigenous women of today, and that they are the backbone of our families and our tribal mm-hmm. communities. And there's a large urban population here in Spokane. Yeah. We don't think about it, but we are the largest metropolitan center between like Seattle and Minnesota. Yeah. And so people migrate through Spokane for a lot of reasons. And so we have a large Indigenous population here in the city of Spokane.
Yes, which I'm glad we were able to turn out to celebrate that
yeah,
day.
Yeah.
Okay. I
do have one thing,
yeah,
more thing.
Yeah, anything you want to share.
So Alex, one thing that I'd like to mention is, you know, I do a lot of work with murdered, missing Indigenous women.
Yes.
So as I mentioned, that Spokane is a corridor. I-90, a lot of people travel, whether it's, you know, going to Seattle through to the Montanas. There is an ever-increasing number of Indigenous women and people that go missing. So as an attorney, as an urban planning professor, I do research on mobility and transportation, okay. how tribal people move, and why we have this epidemic of Indigenous women and people going missing. One of our highest rates is in Yakima. Okay. And, you know, you have the issue going on across the country. But Washington State is making some progress and doing some work. My partner and I worked with the Washington State Patrol to advocate for a representative in Eastern Washington. Mm-hmm. So the Washington State Patrol has two tribal liaisons, one in Western Washington, Patty Ghosh, and one in Eastern Washington, Don Pullen. In fact, I'd recommend you visit with her.
Yeah.
Looking at the epidemic of murdered, missing Indigenous women, it's because the jurisdictional complexities of criminal law on federal Indian reservations. The United States government in their federal policies has made it really hard for tribes to prosecute perpetrators in Indian country. And Indian country is just not on the reservation. It's also in Airway Heights. You know, mm-hmm. we have the Spokane Tribal Casino as well as Northern Quest. And that's Indian country. Those are native lands with tribal jurisdiction. And the current complexity of federal Indian law makes it hard to prosecute individuals committing crimes in Indian country. So, you know, I just encourage your listeners And viewers, if you see something, say something. There's an app called Truckers Against Trafficking that you can report if you see something suspect. And then also just looking out for folks that are in foster care system. You know, my partner and I, we have been foster parents in the past. And in the future, we'd like to, you know, have more kids to help support kids in foster homes. So be a foster parent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big topic for us to cover, missing missing and murdered Indigenous women, right? Mm-hmm. Is there a way besides seeing something and saying something, what are additional things that you think we could probably support?
Right.
Our
so there's a whole bunch of contributing causes, right? You know, you have a people who have lost, you know, their culture and identity in large factor because of United States government policies. They put our grandmothers in boarding schools and didn't allow us to speak our language. It was really hard on our humanity. And so today we have tribal people that are getting educated and, you know, becoming lawyers and teachers, but that we continue to struggle.
Yeah.
There are still issues. You know, of course, the opioid epidemic and fentanyl, it reaches all races, not just people of color. You know, lots of non-natives were caught up in the opioid epidemic, but substance abuse is still an issue for my people. So supporting good programs like the Healing Lodge. Here in the city of Spokane, we are fortunate in that we have the Healing Lodge of Seven Nations, which is a tribal youth treatment facility. And it provides services for young people struggling with addiction. So support the Healing Lodge.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm working with the Healing Lodge. We're trying to build a female facility. Right now, we combine them. And so some tribes don't send their children here, their teens. But we're working on building a new female housing facility at the Healing Lodge of Seven Nations.
Okay. I feel like we could keep on talking and dig deeper into a lot of this.
Yeah.
So I really appreciate your time and all the work that you're doing. Mm-hmm. And you've been a great partner, I think, for us and sharing obstacles that you see and problems that we probably need to address and helping us create a community of belonging. Which I think it's work in progress, but I really appreciate that.
All right. Well, thanks, Alex.
Thank you.